Welcome back, and in this lesson, I want to talk through how we implement DNSSEC using Route 53. Now, if you haven't already watched my DNS and DNSSEC fundamentals video series, you should pause this video and watch those before continuing. Assuming that you have, let's jump in and get started. Now, you should be familiar with this architecture. This is how Route 53 works normally. In this example, I'm using the animalsforlife.org domain, so a query against this would start with our laptop, go to a DNS resolver, then to the root servers looking for details of the .org top level domain, and then it would go to the .org top level domain name servers looking for animalsforlife.org, and then it would proceed to the four name servers which are hosting the animalsforlife.org zone using Route 53. On the right hand side here we have an AWS VPC using the +2 address, which is the Route 53 resolver, and those instances can query the animalsforlife.org domain from inside the VPC. Now, enabling DNSSEC on a Route 53 hosted zone is done from either the Route 53 console UI or the CLI, and once initiated, the process starts with KMS. This part can either be done separately or as part of enabling DNSSEC signing for the hosted zone, but in either case, an asymmetric key pair is created within KMS, meaning a public part and a private part. Now, you can think of these conceptually as the key signing keys, or KSKs, but in actual fact, the KSK is created from these keys. These aren't the actual keys, but this is a nuance which isn't required at this level. So these keys are used to create the public and private key signing keys which Route 53 uses. And these keys need to be in the US East 1 region. That's really important, so keep that in mind. Next, Route 53 creates the zone signing keys internally. This is really important to understand, both the creation and the management of the zone signing keys is handled internally within Route 53. KMS isn't involved. Next, Route 53 adds the key signing key and the zone signing key public parts into a DNS key record within the hosted zone. This tells any DNSSEC resolvers which public keys to use to verify the signatures on any other records in this zone. Next, the private key signing key is used to sign those DNS key records and create the RRSIG DNS key record. And these signatures mean that any DNSSEC resolver can verify that the DNS key records are valid and unchanged. Now, at this point, that's signing within the zone configured, which is step one. Next, Route 53 has to establish the chain of trust with the parent zone. The parent zone needs to add a DS record or delegated signer record, which is a hash of the public part of the key signing key for this zone, and so we need to make this happen. Now, how we do this depends on if the domain is registered via Route 53. If so, the registered domains area of the Route 53 console or the equivalent CLI command can be used to make this change. Route 53 will liaise with the appropriate top-level domain and add the delegated signer record. Now, if we didn't register the domain using Route 53 and are instead just using it to host the zone, then we're going to need to perform this step manually. Once done, the top level domain, in this case .org, will trust this domain via the delegated signer record, which, as I mentioned, is a hash of the domain's public key signing key. And the domain zone will sign all records within it either using the key signing or zone signing keys. As part of enabling this, you should also make sure to configure CloudWatch alarms, specifically create alarms for DNSSEC internal failure and DNSSEC key signing keys needing action. Both of these indicate a DNSSEC issue with the zone which needs to be resolved urgently, either an issue with the key signing key itself or a problem interacting with KMS. Lastly, you might want to consider enabling DNSSEC validation for VPCs. This means for any DNSSEC enabled zones, if any records fail validation due to a mismatched signature or otherwise not being trusted, they won't be returned. This doesn't impact non-DNSSEC enabled zones, which will always return results. And this is how to work with the Route 53 implementation of DNSSEC. What I wanted to do now is step you through an actual implementation of DNSSEC for a hosted zone within Route 53. And to do that, we're going to need to move across to my AWS console. Okay, so now we're at the AWS console, and I'm going to step you through an example of enabling DNSSEC on a Route 53 domain. And to get started, I'm going to make sure I'm in an AWS account where I have admin permissions. In this case, I'm logged in as the IAM admin user, which is an IAM identity with admin permissions. As always, I'm going to make sure that I have the Northern Virginia region selected. And once I've done that, I'm going to go ahead and open Route 53 in a new tab. In my case, it's already inside Recently Visited Services. If it's not, you can just search for it in the search box at the top. But I'm going to go ahead and open Route 53. So I'm going to go to the Route 53 console and click on Hosted Zones. And in my case, I've got two hosted zones, animalsforlife.org and animalsforlife1337.org. I'm going to go ahead and DNSSEC enable animalsforlife.org. So I'm going to go ahead and go inside this hosted zone. Now, if I just go ahead and move across to my command prompt, and if I run this command, so dig animalsforlife.org and then DNS key with plus DNSSEC, this will query this domain attempting to look for any DNS key records using DNSSEC. And as you can see, there are no DNSSEC results returned, which is logical because this domain is not enabled for DNSSEC. So moving back to this console, I'm going to click on DNSSEC signing under the domain and then click on enable DNSSEC signing. Now, if this were a production domain, the order of these steps really matters, and you need to make sure that you wait for certain time periods before conducting each of these steps. Specifically, you need to make sure that you're making changes taking into consideration the TTL values within your domain. I'll include a link attached to this video which details all of these time-critical prerequisites that you need to make sure you consider before enabling DNS signing. In my case, I don't need to worry about that because this is a fresh, empty domain. The first thing we're going to do is create a key signing key. And as I mentioned earlier in this video, this is done using a KMS key. So the first thing I'm going to do is to specify a KSK name, so a key signing key name. And I'm going to call it A4L KSK for Animals for Life key signing key. Next, you'll need to decide on which key to use within KMS to create this key signing key. Now, unfortunately, the user interface is a little bit inconsistent. AWS have decided to rename CMKs to KMS keys, so you might see the interface looking slightly different when you're doing this video. Regardless, you need to create a KMS key. So check the box saying create customer managed CMK or create KMS key, depending on what state the user interface is in. And you'll need to give a name to this key. And again, this is creating an asymmetric KMS key. So I'm going to call it A4L KSK and then KMS key. And once I've done that, I can go ahead and click on Create KSK and Enable Signing. Now, behind the scenes, this is creating an asymmetric KMS key and using this to create the key signing key pair that this hosted zone is going to use. Now, this part of the process can take a few minutes, and so I'm going to skip ahead until this part has completed. Okay, so that's completed, and that means that we now have an active key signing key within this hosted zone. And that means it's also created a zone signing key within this hosted zone. If I go back to my terminal and I rerun this same command and press enter, you'll see that we still get the same empty results, and this can be because of caching, so I need to wait a few minutes before this will update. If I run it again, now we can see for the same query, it now returns DNS key records, so one for 256, which represents the zone signing key, so the public part of that key pair, and one for 257, which represents the key signing key, again, the public part of that key pair. And then we have the corresponding RRSIG DNS key record, which is a signature of these using the private key signing key. So now internally, we've got DNSSEC signing enabled for this hosted zone. And what we need to do now is create the chain of trust with the parent zone, in this case, the .org top level domain. Now to do that, because I've also registered this domain using Route 53, I can do that from the registered domains area of the console. So I'll open that in a brand new tab. I'm going to go there, and then I'm going to go to the animalsforlife.org registered domain. And this is the area of the console where I can make changes, and Route 53 will liaise with the .org top level domain and enter those changes into the .org zone. Now the area that I'm specifically interested in is the DNSSEC status. Currently, this is set to disabled. What I'm going to do is to click on Manage Keys, and it's here where I can enter the public key. Specifically, it's going to be the public key signing key of the animalsforlife.org zone, and I'm going to enter it so that it creates the delegated signer record in the .org domain, which establishes this chain of trust. So first I'm going to change the key type to KSK, then I'm going to go back to our hosted zone, and I'm going to click on View Information to create DS record. Then I'm going to expand Establish a Chain of Trust, and depending on what type of registrar you used, you either need to follow the bottom instructions or these if you used Route 53. And I did, so I can go ahead and use the Route 53 registrar details. Now the first thing you need to do is to make sure that you're using the correct signing algorithm. So it's ECDS AP 256 SHA-256. So I'm going to go ahead and move back to the registered domains console, click on the algorithm dropdown, and select the matching signing algorithm. So ECDS AP 256 SHA-256. Next, I'll go back, and I'll need to copy the public key into my clipboard. So remember, a delegated signer record is just a hash of the public part of a key signing key. So this is what I'm copying into my clipboard. This is the public key of this key signing key. So I'm going to go back and paste this in, and then click on Add. Now this is going to initiate a process where Route 53 are going to make the changes to the animalsforlife.org part of the .org top level domain zone. So specifically in the .org top level domain zone, there's going to be an entry for animalsforlife.org. By default for normal DNS, this is going to contain name server records which delegate through to Route 53. What this process is going to do is also add a DS record, which is a delegated signer record, and it is going to contain a hash of this public key. Now that will take a few minutes to take effect. That's not a process which only involves Route 53. It also involves the .org top level domain, so it can take a few minutes. It can actually take anywhere up to a few hours and depends somewhat on the top level domain as well as the relationship with that entity which Route 53 has. So I'm just going to go ahead and refresh this. We can see that the DNSSEC status has changed and we've now got this entry. So now if I move back to my terminal, I'm going to clear the screen to make it easier to see. And now I'm going to run this command, so dig space org, because I want to do a query on the org top level domain, space ns, and then a space plus short, and this will give me a listing of the authoritative name servers for the .org top level domain, and I'm going to pick one of those servers. So I'm going to go ahead and pick the top one, then I'm going to run this command, so dig animalsforlife.org, which is my hosted zone, then a space, I want to query DS records, so delegated signers, then an @ sign, and then the host name of the .org top-level domain name server. So this is going to mean that we're querying one specific name server, and then press Enter. Now, if you don't see any DS record returned, again, it's because of DNS caching. And again, there is a delay between when you make the changes within Route 53 and when this takes effect within the DNS hierarchy. So I'll clear the screen again, rerun that command. Again, I'm not getting any DS record returned. So at this point, I'm going to skip ahead to when the .org top-level domain have updated with the changes that we've just made. Now, in my case, after about 5 more minutes, this was added. So note I've run the same command, so dig space animalsforlife.org and then ds for delegated signer and then @ and then one of the .org TLD name servers. So I'm querying for the delegated signer record for my domain, and we can see here in the answers section, we've got it here, so animalsforlife, DS for delegated signer, and then here we've got the record, and this record contains a hash of my public key signing key that's used for the animalsforlife.org domain. So now I've established the chain of trust from the .org top-level domain through to my hosted zone inside AWS, and then because I've enabled DNSSEC signing, it means if I create any records within this domain, then they too will be signed. So if I test that, if I go ahead and click on Create Record, I'm going to use simple routing, define a simple record. I'm going to call this test, so test.animalsforlife.org. It's going to be an A record type. I'm going to choose IP address or another value, and then I'm just going to enter a test IP address, so 1.1.1.1 and a TTL of 1 minute. And then I'm going to define that simple record and create the record. Now, if I just refresh this, inside the hosted zone for the UI, you won't see anything which looks different. However, if I move back to my terminal, clear the screen to make it easy to see, and do a dig space test.animalsforlife.org, and then a space, and then A, and press Enter, that's going to do a normal DNS query for this A record. So we can see it, test.animalsforlife.org, it's an A record, and then it points at 1.1.1.1. If I run the same command, only now put plus DNSSEC and press Enter, now we can see, in addition to the normal DNS query result, now we have the DNSSEC RRSIG, and this is a signature of the record above using the private part of the zone signing key, and this signature can be verified using the DNS key record, which contains the public zone signing key. So now we have an end-to-end chain of trust from the DNS route all the way through to this resource record. Now that's everything I wanted to cover in this video. I just wanted to give you an overview of how to implement DNSSEC within Route 53, both from a theory and practical perspective. At this point, that's the end of the video, so go ahead and complete the video, and when you're ready, I'll look forward to you joining me in the next.